Sri Alagappan, directors of the UWC, distinguished members of the audience. I must thank UWC and particularly my friend Sri Mahalingam for inviting me to speak on this session on the budget. And at his request, I think most of you have heard different lectures on the budget, and he asked me to speak on another important topic, GST, which has been touted as the biggest tax reform in India's economic history. Well, I've been told that my time is 20 minutes. I'll be brief. I fully understand that at 8:10 in the evening, the last thing you want to hear is a lecture on taxation. But please bear with me and I'll be brief as possible. My personal view is that GST is the most terrible thing that will happen to this country. It is, somebody said that you can't stop an idea whose time has come. In my personal view, GST is a horrible idea whose time should not come, but unfortunately it will come. And I don't say this to shock people or to dramatize something, but I say it out of strong personal conviction. I still cannot fathom how anybody can conceive and implement this concept of GST that is going to come 120 days from now. Why do I say that GST is a bad idea? Now let's understand our concepts first. GST is nothing but VAT in most countries. You got value added tax, because the idea is that you don't levy tax on tax from the raw material to the final output stage and sale. You only pay tax on the value addition, so you avoid the cascading effect of taxes. That is the basic thing of GST. Now, throughout the world, you have basically one GST. I think Canada and Brazil are two countries which have dual GST, but most countries have one GST. You go to Singapore, whether you go to a bar and have a drink or you go and buy an electronic item in a shop, you just pay 7% Singapore GST. Now, my fundamental objection with GST is what we are calling GST is not GST. Look at what's happening now. What's the current state of situation? Today you have 29 states, so you have 29 state taxes, VAT acts or sales tax acts. You have one service tax. You have one excise duty. So basically you got 29 plus 1 plus 1, 31, and one service tax, 32. What is going to happen to our GST? Now I can understand if we implement GST and have one GST, which is what is called one nation, one tax, then I have no problems. But what is happening, look at the difficulty what's going to happen now. You are going to have, now the constitution has been amended. Under the 101st amendment to the constitution, we have a new article called Article 246A, which says, Parliament and the states can levy tax on the supply of goods and services. Parliament and the states can levy tax on the supply of goods and services. So, not only Parliament, but each state government can levy its own GST. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have and we are going to have 29 different VAT laws, which is called SGST, state government taxes. You're going to have one CGST for interstate transactions, and you're going to have one IGST, what's called inter-GST. So, you're going to have 31 laws replacing 32 laws now. For the life of me, I don't know how it is going to simplify things. And why do I say that? Article 246A says that every state can levy a GST. Now, we are a federal structure. Dr. Ambedkar said that the essence of our constitution is a partition between the lawmaking power given to Parliament and the lawmaking power given to the state, a partition. The Supreme Court has said that state governments are not appendages of the Parliament. And on 11th of December 2016, the 9-judge bench in the entry tax case said that every state is as sovereign as Parliament in its power to levy taxes. So there is nothing that stops one state government from going on its own path. Article 279A introduces a GST council whose powers are only recommendatory. So today there is nothing to stop a maverick government from going on a different path or at least distorting the entire GST system. Now, apart from this horrendously complex thing, and that's why I said that this, I'm quite amazed at the debate which says that GST is going to be the panacea for all evils, it's going to increase GDP by 2%. What's the basis of these submissions? I just don't understand. Now just look at this particular point. I personally believe that the existing system was good. The problem is not with the law, the problem is the implementation of the law, the leakages in the system. Now how are you going to administer this together? Now look at the situation that is going to happen now. I personally believe we are a federal country, more diverse than the European Union. I mean, there is more difference between Jharkhand and Tamil Nadu than there is between Portugal and, say, Italy. Now, what is good for Jharkhand, what is good for Chhattisgarh is not good for Maharashtra and vice versa. But you're going to have one kind of GST putting everybody into the same problem, into the same situation. So I think that it is going to lead to more complexity, more uncertainty, and procedurally it's going to be more difficult. And I'll make good my submission. Let's say today I'm running a diagnostic center. I'm a service provider. I have to file 2 service tax returns in a year. Now, come September 2017, and when this wonderful dream comes true of GST, what's going to happen to a service provider? He has to file 3 returns a month, on the 10th, on the 15th, and the 20th, all online. So he files 3 returns a month, so he files 36 returns on 10th, 15th and 20th. Then he has to then file 12 tedious returns, which is 36 plus 12, 48. And he has to file 1 annual return, which is 49. So mathematically speaking, a person who was filing just 2 service tax returns has to file 49 returns. And this is no exaggeration, please see the fine print. And if I got diagnostic centers in 9 states, I must file 9 into 49 because each state is autonomous. And just imagine the load on the system. All people have to file only on the 10th. And those of you who have visited the websites of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs or the Tamil Nadu Sales Tax Department, you know how difficult it's going to be to load these systems. I always believe that demonetization caused tremendous collateral damage. Tremendous collateral damage. And I fear that you're going to implement GST into a system, into a country, which is still not ready for it. You're going to implant a tree where the soil is still not ready to take it. See, we talk, what is the threshold limit? You're going to say anybody about 20 lakhs comes into GST. 20 lakhs per year. Just think of a service provider, let us say in Sholapur, or a service provider in Jaisalmer. What is the computer is going to have? What is the online system is going to have? What is the data support that he's going to have? Yet we headlong go into this concept of GST. The other fear which I've got as far as GST is concerned, the enormous potential for tax evasion. One unique feature of GST throughout the world is that there's only one rate of tax. In Singapore, you don't have 7% on shoes, 12% on jewelry, 40% on liquor. No, it's just one GST, 7% flat. But what are the rates we are talking of? 0%, 5%, 12%, 18%, 28%. And if you see last week's statement, it's very worrisome. We first thought that 28% will be only for a few items. Now they say no. Wherever we are going to forego VAT and service tax, we are going to make it 28%. I just want you to ask, whatever else our virtues are, paying taxes is not one of them. The entire economy is basically cash. I was talking to the director of Glaxo. For the first time in 54 years, the Glaxo factory shut down because there was nobody to buy. Everything is in cash. Whether you like it or not, that's the reality. Now, if you're going to make it 28% at the retail level, just imagine the amount of tax evasion. I did a lot of work in Central Excise. You know, we had this system. My previous speaker spoke about the reforms and so on. But we had for many, many years a horrendous system of excise duty. For example, shampoo. Shampoo was taxed at 110%. If you studied the excise tariff, anything which made you feel good was taxed heavily. Because under socialism, all of us had to be miserable. So you buy a nice polyester fiber cloth, you pay 40% duty. Buy shampoo, you pay 110% duty. But you go and buy a Khadi Gramodyog soap made without the aid of power, no duty. So this was the whole structure. Now what did people do? If your turnover was less than 5 lakhs, no duty. More than 5 lakhs and up to 15 lakhs, 110% duty. So what people did was, you had throughout Pondicherry, Cuddalore and so on, I remember those days, we did so many excise cases, housewives will have shampoo making machines, they'll make up to 4,90,000, stop for the year, again next year make. So everybody made less than 5 lakhs and then you had amendment after amendment after amendment to plug these loopholes. Now just imagine if you've got 20 lakh threshold, You're going to have mushrooming of these multiple enterprises. Mr. Arvind Datar has got one, Mrs. Arvind Datar, son-in-law, daughter-in-law, all have multiple shops, and this is going to happen. It's a very, very real scenario which we don't realize. So ladies and gentlemen, I would just like you to pause and think whether GST is a good idea. And when I wrote articles on this, I was asked that what is the suggestion you have? It's very easy to criticize. My suggestion was that before you roll it out, try it on a trial basis. Try it on, say, 3 manufacturing units, 3 service sectors, 3 other traders, and see what are the difficulties in implementing GST. I still feel that our country is not suited for a national GST, but then if disasters are to happen, they will. Now, in the short time I've got, I just want to discuss 2 more things which are causing me great concern. My previous speaker mentioned about stimulating growth and importance of growth and so on and so forth. As a tax lawyer, mainly, I've always marveled. I mean, pardon me, but in my opinion, after almost 4 decades at the bar, in my opinion, there are only 3 dream budgets. Only 3 budgets were really reformative in terms of taxation. One was C. Subramanian's budget in 1975, when he brought the tax from 97% to 75%. The best budget, in my opinion, was V.P. Singh's budget, and the next was Manmohan Singh's budget in 1991. They were the 3 real budgets where they understood that taxes are a byproduct of growth. It always baffles me when they say, I want service tax, manufacturing, excise duty to go up by 18%. How does excise duty go up by 18% if your production doesn't go up by 5%, doesn't go up by 5%? Then you have all sorts of absurd demands. And one most difficult thing, I speak to so many clients, speak to so many chartered accountants and so on. If there is one thing which worries investors, and we have so many titans of industry here, it is the most hostile, unfriendly tax regime. An investment climate must be fertile. You must nurture growth. Today, if a young man wants to start a business, why will he want to start up a factory? Why does he hesitate to start a factory? And in my opinion, the answer is the worst thing to our investment climate is toxic taxes. I always believe that our words are make in India, but our taxes say quit India. That is the reality. And why do I say this? Mr. Chidambaram mentioned about amendments and so on. There are good. One of the worst budgets was the retrospective amendment in the Vodafone case. I wrote an article in Business Line. I said, I really hope that we don't retrospectively amend this particular decision. It sent a fantastic message. The 12th January 2012 was the date of the Vodafone judgment. And it sent a huge message that whether it is 1 billion or 11 billion or 44,000 crores, the laws are equal. The Supreme Court of India delivers justice whoever it is. And I said, I hope they don't retrospectively amend, because India has had a track record of the largest number of retrospective amendments in the world. What has happened to this budget? Nobody talks about the fine print. 31 judgments have been overruled in this budget prospectively, because Mr. Jaitley said, I won't do it retrospectively. Every time you lose a case, you amend the law and add an explanation. Section 1023C has 19 provisos and 7 explanations. Every time there's a judgment of the court in favor of the SSC, amend the law. Now, is it not insulting to your judiciary? And now coming to these 2 points, I have to conclude in my 20-minute thing. One is called GAR and one is called POEM. These are 2 acronyms which, in my opinion, GAR will be very, very difficult, dangerous for the domestic plus foreign industry, and POEM can have very serious impact on FDI investment. And I'll just explain to you what it basically is. Pardon me for being technical. I know it's 8:30 and I can't imagine visiting more punishment on you than speak on taxes. Now GAR, General Anti-Avoidance Rule. Throughout the world, there is a accepted principle that if you exploit a loophole, that should not be tolerated. I don't subscribe to that view, because essentially the difference is tax evasion and tax avoidance. Tax evasion is a crime. And an English judge said that the difference between tax evasion and tax avoidance, is the thickness of a prison wall. That's the difference between tax evasion and tax avoidance. Now, They say tax planning is good, but tax avoidance is bad. What is the subtle difference? The courts have made a very fine distinction and said that if you take advantage of a loophole in the law, an unintended benefit you take, then that is a tax avoidance which is impermissible. So you have general anti-avoidance rules. Now in the UK and Europe and throughout and the OECD model in international tax treaties, you have anti-abuse rules that if you have a particular scheme where there is no commercial purpose, the only purpose is to avoid tax, you create a trust, you create a body who has no commercial purpose but to take advantage of a legal loophole, that will be anti-avoidance, and that under Section 207 of the UK Act is not permissible at all. Now we have GAR, and believe me, I've made some study, our GAR is going to have serious repercussions for the domestic industry and the international industry unless in the industry, ASSOCHAM, FICCI all get together and protest to the finance minister. Now just to tell you in simple terms, what is this anti-avoidance rule? It says that the government will attack impermissible tax avoidance agreements. Impermissible tax avoidance agreements. So by definition, when you say impermissible tax avoidance agreement, that means some are permissible. So you can only tax what is impermissible. But the definition is so horrendous. And I'll give you an example of what the government does even without GAR. Right now we are doing a case in the Supreme Court. All of you have heard of mergers, amalgamations. Under Section 72 of the Income Tax Act, you encourage a sick company to be taken over by a healthy company. Right? You want to save employment, you don't want people to go out of jobs. So when the loss-making company merges into the profit-making company, what happens? Their sales are combined, and naturally the losses of the transferor company, the loss-making company, become part of the profit-making company. So the profit-making company's profits drop. If I've got 10 lakhs of income and I take a 4 lakh loss company, then my profit will be 6 lakhs, elementary. Now if I pay tax on 10 lakhs, and I get this 6 lakhs loss, so my income has become 4 lakhs, so I'm entitled for a refund. I hope all of you have seen this very simple point. Now there's a large group which made consolidation. It said, okay, our, let's say, chemical division will be together, our power division will be together, and there was a reconstruction. Because of one particular plant did not work, there was strike, there was a PIL, etc., there was huge unabsorbed depreciation. It went into the profit-making company. Mind you, it involves more than 11,000 employees. All jobs were saved. Now, because of this merger, the profit-making company which took over the loss-making company had to get a refund of 500 crores. And today, that merger was challenged in a PIL. Bombay High Court dismissed the writ petition. Writ appeal dismissed. Went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court approved the merger. And ladies and gentlemen, now the Income Tax Department filed an application saying that this is a tax fraud because claiming the whole amalgamation was fraudulent because they wanted to claim refund. And the Supreme Court is hearing. This is a serious argument we advanced even without GAR. Now look, what does GAR say? And this is the most dangerous part, and this definition is not there in any civilized country I've seen. I made research about 16 countries. No country has this particular provision. Now what is GAR? Impermissible avoidance agreement. So if I have a merger, and I take loss and I get a refund, that is impermissible. Why? Will it continue? Because please go home, those who are chartered accountants or in finance, please see what is the definition of tax benefit. If you have got any transaction, now this is the two dangerous provisions of GAR, there's no time to get into the balance. Suppose you have a planning, suppose you have an expansion scheme, or you want to convert a company into an LLP, a limited liability partnership. Every transaction has tax consequences. It has tax implications. Now suppose you do a particular transaction. Now suppose you do a particular transaction just to pay more tax, then you require to be undergo special treatment. Right? If any company decides to go into a transaction just to pay more tax, then it requires serious psychological help. So one of the factors which you'll do in your transaction, see what's the tax impact? What's the tax effect of this transaction? If I do this, will I pay more tax? Will I pay less tax? And any prudent person will say, all right, let me choose the option where I'll pay the least amount of tax. That's common human nature. Now the law in India says, if your transaction has several steps, and I'm not exaggerating, and even if one step is going to result in a reduction on tax, it will be presumed that your intention was to evade tax, and you must prove that it was not your intention. And believe me, ladies and gentlemen, in law, proving is a very serious thing. When you prove, it's a very difficult thing to prove the negative, that it was not my intention to evade tax, very difficult to prove the negative. Now, what was my intention? To get a tax benefit. What is a tax benefit? Look at this most absurd part of the Income Tax Act. A tax benefit is defined in section 102, saying that any benefit or reduction you get under the Act is a tax benefit. So if I make any plan to save tax, it is impermissible avoidance agreement. Now it goes to this, it's obviously shocking. Suppose I go for a merger, it is approved by the High Court, approved by the Supreme Court. Can you say it is impermissible? It is approved by a court of law. Question number 9 in the circular says, suppose the merger or amalgamation is approved by the company court, NCLT or other judicial authority, will it be treated as impermissible avoidance agreement? And now look at the answer. The answer says, if the NCLT or the court has not adequately dealt with the tax aspect, then we will take it as impermissible. So if the Supreme Court approves a merger, the assessing officer in Nagarkoil can say, Justice Nariman of the Supreme Court did not discuss his income tax provision, therefore it is impermissible, I am disallowing the whole thing. And this is what is going to happen. Now the last thing on poem, and I'll conclude. Poem is called Place of Effective Management. I'm sure all of you are going to require a drink after all this. You see, in international taxation, there are two basic principles. When does India tax a person? India will tax a person if either the person stays in India, he's a resident of India, or the income source is in India. So the two rules of international taxation are the source rule and the residence rule. This is very elementary. Now, an Indian company is liable to income tax if it's resident in India. So if a registered company is in India, it will be liable to tax, no problems. Now, when is a foreign company resident in India? The Income Tax Act says a foreign company, though registered, say, in Mauritius or in Italy, will be a resident of India if it is wholly managed from India. Wholly managed from India. That's called the control management theory. Now, internationally, we go to place of effective management. The company will be resident where it is effectively managed. Section is very simple. Section copies the UN model, the OECD model. There's no difficulty. The difficulty is in the 8-page circular, which has made all sorts of things as to when the place of effective management will be in India. Suppose your company is in, say, Japan. Suppose Suzuki is in Japan. And let's assume that it has got some work in India, and at one point of time in the year, 50% of its employees are working in India, or 50% of its non-active income is from India, then a Japanese company will be treated as an Indian company and made to pay tax accordingly. So POEM is a very, very dangerous thing. It is going to have a serious impact on FDI investments. And of course, people say that there will be Achhe Din for industry. And one of the biggest oxymorons is a tax-friendly administration. In my 35 years, I've hardly seen anything. The whole difficulty is, and I don't blame the officers, you have absurd revenue targets and you make the most absurd demands to meet those targets. In the Supreme Court, when we got the entity struck down, the government filed a paper. Out of the demands they make, 77% cases of the department which are launched are eventually held against the department. 77%. So, most of the demands which are raised knowing that they are not sustainable, but you just raise them to raise the money and then let the client keep on fighting up to the Supreme Court. I really hope that things will change, and unless we realize that taxes are only a byproduct and not the main thing, nothing is going to happen. I only hope that we prove Ralph Waldo Emerson wrong when he said that, you know, we'll do better in the future. He said, tell me not what you propose to do, because what you have done thunders so loudly in my ears that I cannot hear you to the contrary. Thank you.
We have one question from the floor. Question reads, what is your view on GST with respect to the financial services sector?
Well, with the financial service, in fact, all professionals, there's a lot of problems in the financial service sector. One is multiple services. Suppose you're a service professional working in different states, what happens? Suppose I'm a lawyer. Now, for a lawyer or a chartered accountant, the practical difficulty are going to be, suppose I go and practice in Delhi for some time. Do I require registration there? For financial services, for most of us, the main problems are going to be in terms of interstate services, how are they going to be taxed? If you have got branches in different states, do you require multiple registrations? Do you require multiple returns? These are all going to be problems which are going to face service providers in multiple states.